I'd like to introduce Professor Peter Dubruel, who's going to talk to us about novel wound dressings and polymers.
Yep. Thank you very much for the introduction. And first of all, let me say that it's a real pleasure to have the possibility to present here today. After the presentation of Rachel, I think a couple of very interesting aspects have been touched upon. But really one thing which is always striking my mind is how complex the entire wound healing process is. Now, I will be tackling things from a somewhat different point of view. My background is in polymer chemist, and I would not scare you off with many, many polymer chemical structures, but at least I will try to introduce to you how certain types of materials, being polymers, can be used for treating certain wounds. And I will only try to do that. I will also try to explain you where, at least in our opinion, DERMA project partners and others, where some innovation might still be present. Now, if you look at those images here, I think we're all well aware that polymers are all around. Now, as a polymer chemist, it's easy to say that chemistry is almost everything which we do during a day. But the interesting thing is that each of those materials, like Teflon for those people who like cooking, polyurethanes, insulation materials, plastic bottles, PMMA, artificial glass, and others. But for each of those polymers, you also quite often have a medical application which is directly situated behind that. And we're all aware of implants like an artificial heart, which can be composed of a material which is like a polyurethane. Stand materials, which in the, let's say, decades ago were still non-polymeric in nature, have now slowly moved to be developed starting from biodegradable polymers. And also some very interesting coatings containing certain drugs can be applied on that. For those people wearing contact lenses, you have soft contact lenses, hard contact lenses, but also intraocular lenses are quite often made from polymers, which are nothing else than this type of PMMA-type materials, which are produced on ton scale in Europe, the US, and Asia. Now, for people suffering from cardiovascular problems, being the number one killer worldwide, a material which is called PET, polyethylene terephthalate, which we quite often are daily confronted with when you drink water from a plastic water bottle. Exactly the same type of polymer, of course with a higher grade and a different processing method, is applied as bypass for occluded blood vessels. And again, a polymer like PMMA, artificial glass, is daily used in the clinical practice for fixing artificial hips while patients are in a horizontal position, being subject to a hip replacement. Now, what I will try to do today is to explain you some concepts on polymers and how polymers, in our opinion, can be applied in the field of wound treatment. And you will see some terminology which I will explain, but you will also see some polymer processing techniques, some of which are very historical, dating back to World War II, but which have been more recently reinvented in the medical field. And if you look at, the full material food chain in between, the design of a material and the modeling and a final medical application, you have a large variety of steps. And within DERMA, our group really feels honored to be involved in various steps. One of them is the development of novel polymers that can be used for treating some of those wounds. Those polymers are subsequently used using several processing technologies to come up with a final material, because developing a polymer as such typically takes you in between 1 hour and 24 hours, but bringing it to a final material that can be brought in contact with the patient needs quite some innovative steps, processing the material in a final shape, sometimes also apply unique coatings on those materials to elicit certain body reactions. A large amount of polymers which are available now already will not harm the patient when they are implanted, but if you want those polymers to stimulate the formation of new tissue, then quite often you need to apply certain coatings to make sure that the tissue surrounding the implant is reacting in a correct way to your implant material. And applications range from orthopedic applications, development of a menisci. This is an example of a bioartificial liver device in which liver cells are embedded in a printed hydrogel structure with the aim, in the long run, to replace part of a malfunctioning liver. Now, for those people in the audience who are not chemists, and more specifically not polymer chemists, I will very briefly touch upon to some concepts which are, in our opinion, the project partners from DERMA, very important to understand why polymers might indeed meet the needs of, or at least certain needs, in the field of wound treatment. Now, why polymers and why you're not using ceramics or metals for these applications? That's quite obvious. Polymers have mechanical properties that actually match the mechanical properties of most tissues in our body. And very interestingly, if you look at how a polymer is actually made, you start from certain building blocks, we call that a monomer, and then with a simple reaction, you can connect all those small building blocks into a very long polymer chain. Now, what you see here is probably the most simple polymer on Earth. You have one building block, and that leads to a polymer which is only composed of one repeating unit. Now, the beauty of polymer technology is actually situated in the fact that by combining various types of monomers, you can end up with so-called copolymers, which are composed of two, three, or four different monomers. So, depending on your final application, you can actually add functionalities by carefully selecting these type of monomers before conversion into a polymer. Now, typically, several types of polymers exist. You have synthetic polymers, and all the examples I've listed here are examples of synthetic polymers which are being man-made. A very important second class of polymers is actually the natural polymers, and everybody knows DNA, which determines whether you have blue, green, or brown eyes. But some other materials like proteins and polysaccharides are two other prominent examples of these types of so-called natural polymers or biopolymers. And now what I will be talking about quite a bit today is actually how the combination of proteins and polysaccharides can actually be a very elegant tool to try to develop the most suited wound dressing material. And the fact that proteins and polysaccharides are indeed applicable for that is actually based on the fact that all our living cells within our bodies are nicely located within something which is called the extracellular matrix. And this matrix is composed of these two constituents. And from that, so by learning from nature, we're actually trying to combine those two to develop novel materials which mimic the extracellular matrix. Now, after a very nice presentation of Rachel, I will not take you through definitions of what the wound dressing is, but I will directly move to this picture here, which actually represents the wound dressing material itself. And you see that within this wound dressing material, you have a variety of components. And one very important one is, of course, the possibility to include in such a wound dressing material certain bioactive compounds. And I will come back to some examples later on. But by carefully selecting what the starting material is of your wound dressing material, you can actually control several parameters. Which type of bioactive compounds can you load? What amount of compounds can you indeed load in such a material? And more importantly also, is there a way to control how quick those bioactive compounds are released from the matrix into the surrounding wound area? And some of those things will come back in the following slides. Now, if you look at the field of wound dressings, then there is a very large amount of companies who are already commercializing those wound dressings. Various systems exist, going from hydrocolloids to hydrogels, foams, skin substitutes and scaffolds, as we already heard from Rachel in the previous presentation. Now, if you look at all the names, or let's say the different possibilities for wound dressings, then this list here is only a very small example of all the commercially available wound dressings on the market. Honestly speaking, if you look at some of them, I'm not always sure that the companies will really like this the saying, but each of them has a large amount of advantages, but quite often also suffers from some disadvantages. And having one material that meets all the needs is, in our opinion, still a big challenge for our field. Now, in the following part of my presentation, what I will try to do is to introduce you some concepts and some variables where the DERMA Consortium believes that there is still some scientific potential in developing the next generation of wound dressings. And I will give some further explanation on how the type of dressing can be varied, I will also very briefly touch upon, for burn wounds, on which type of bioactive compounds can be used, and then a larger part will also be devoted again to production methods. And I will describe some polymer processing methods which could enable the development of wound dressing materials. Now, a couple of slides ago, I introduced you the concept that all our living cells are embedded in something which is called the extracellular matrix. This is here the cell membrane. And actually, the cell membrane at the region away from the cell is actually surrounded by a large combination of proteins and polysaccharides. And collagen is one of those examples of a predominant protein which is present in our bodies. Now, learning from nature in this case actually meant that we need to try to develop a material which mimics this extracellular matrix to the highest extent possible. And there's a certain class of materials which is called an hydrogel. And a hydrogel is actually a network of a hydrophilic polymer. Now, if you look at the word hydrogel, it means actually that if you combine those polymers into a network, that by incubating them in water, they will take up a very large amount of water. And this way, you actually mimic the natural environment of most of our cells in our living bodies. So what are the most, let's say, the most dominant advantage of using a hydrogel? It's the fact that it's a high water content and in that sense already mimics how our tissues look like. The disadvantages are the fact that quite some hydrogels are mechanically unstable. If you increase the temperature of this gel from room temperature to body temperature, this is one example of a gel which just collapses. So if you nicely develop a 3D printed scaffold, which takes you hours and hours to develop, by just increasing the temperature, your structure falls in a smaller shape here within a couple of minutes, which actually is a sign that a certain type of chemical functionalization is still needed on those gels to enable those structures to remain their original shape after implantation. And in some cases, not only the mechanical rigidity or the rigidity as such of a gel is problematic, but some hydrogels also dissolve over time once they are implanted in the body. Now, how can we tackle that problem? By carefully selecting again which building blocks you use for constituting an hydrogel. And in theory, the principle is very simple. Any hydrophilic polymer, so any polymer which is nicely soluble in water, can be used to produce hydrogel materials. But what you need to do is actually to introduce so-called cross-linkable groups. Now, if my 10 fingers are the different polymers from a hydrogel, then what you have to do is you have to link them together in a way that certain bonds are formed, and those bonds should be selected in such a way that you, if you implant that material in the body, that the structure stays stable. The nice thing about this is that some chemical tricks can be actually executed to indeed develop those type of hydrogels by introducing so-called cross-linkable groups. Those groups can be introduced on synthetic polymers, and I will give examples of that later on, but can also be introduced on biopolymers. And you see here two predominant examples which have been already patented decades ago for use in medical fields: gelatine, which is a derivative of collagen, and alginate. So this is a protein derivative, and this is a polysaccharide derivative. So from this two examples, you see directly that certain types of chemistries can be applied on those two types of building blocks. In the long term, the aim is to combine these two together, and with certain functional groups, without going in details, that you introduce on the protein and on the polysaccharide, you can link them together, and not only do that, but in the end, obtain a structure that is stable when you put that material at 37 degrees centigrade and in the normal physiological conditions. Now, for those people who are not aware on how hydrogels are formed, how is that typically done? It's a very easy and straightforward procedure. You start from a solution of your polymer in water, just like a drinking bottle of water, where you don't only have water, but also some polymers. And then by a certain external stimulus, you actually cross-link those polymers together, you link them together, and you have a hydrogel structure which should ideally be stable in the body. Now, which stimuli can be used? You have light irradiation, you have redox systems, but in some cases also the effect of temperature can lead to formation of gels, or in some cases even the effect of salts. Think about alginates, which are heavily used in the dental practice, can be very easily cross-linked through the addition of calcium ions through to a solution. Now, for some applications, also a reversible hydrogel is actually what is aimed for. And from the previous presentation, we have heard the word MMP. Well, certain gels have been developed before where certain chemical linkages are inserted, which are actually prone to cleavage by some of those MMPs which are present in a wound environment. Now, for the type of dressing, where do we see the innovation still? The type and or combination of biopolymers. You can only work with proteins, you can work with polysaccharides, you can combine several things. But honestly speaking, if you keep track on the most recent literature, then the amount of novel polysaccharides which is being described week in, week out, in our opinion, might also open up quite some nice possibilities for developing new wound dressing materials. Which type of crosslinker you're using is a second important thing. And then also, as I already mentioned, for developing a hydrogel, you sometimes need an initiator. And I will come back to that later. But finding systems which are not requiring anymore the use of toxic initiators might also be a very important innovation in the field. Now, in this slide, I will briefly introduce to you in some of the concepts that we will be working on in the DERMA project for developing wound dressings. And again, I will not scare you off with the structure. I will not even try to pronounce the full name of that, because that would take me a too long time in this presentation. And that's why I've actually depicted here this schematic representation of the same polymer. Now, what you need to focus on are two things. First of all, the polymer backbone. And secondly, the end groups, which are acrylates. Now, what in our view the beauty of this technology is the fact that by reacting those end groups, which are again here this carbon-carbon double bonds, which are similar to what I described here for gelatin and alginate, we are able to start from a polymer solution, and by applying UV or some other stimuli, we can link those polymers together to form a 3D scaffold that can be used for releasing certain bioactive compounds. Good, what else can be varied and what else is important? This polymer backbone. And the interesting thing of this patented technology is the fact that the backbone can be biodegradable or non-biodegradable, or it can also be cell interactive or non-cell interactive. So by varying the type of polymer backbone in the middle part of this structure, the other parts of this building block can be kept equal, which means that this type of chemistry is a pretty universal chemistry, which in our opinion opens up quite some possibilities for developing new wound dressings. What are some key advantages? You don't need a photoinitiator anymore. By simply UV irradiating a solution of the polymer 3D crosslinks as such, without the need of these type of toxic photoinitiators. The material is extremely water compatible. What you see here is 9 grams of a polymer, which is solubilized in 1 milliliter of water. Honestly speaking, I'm working in this field for 10 years, and this is the first time I meet a polymer which has such a high water compatibility. And if you now know that we're trying to develop something which mimics the extracellular matrix, then you can well believe that this nicely, or that say that the very high water compatibility is actually something which might mean that this polymer could be a very nice candidate for developing wound dressing. Now, from Rachel, we have also heard that a moist environment is needed, but in some cases, degree of how, or let's say how hydrated a certain wound environment is can be critical. And very interestingly with this technology, by varying here the central part, this polymer backbone, we can actually develop hydrogel building blocks which take up more or less water. And in our opinion, this is one of the beauties of this technology which might lead us to some successes in that field. Now, as you can see here, the material can also be very easily processed into 3D printed shapes, but also 3D electron sponge shapes. And as you can see here on the right, the material in the end is still very flexible, which actually means that, again, by varying this central building block, We can go from very rigid materials to very elastic or flexible materials, all with this one universal technology. So hopefully in the upcoming outreaching events like this one, we'll be able to highlight more of those findings. Now, for the type of bioactive compounds, I've only listed here the example of burn wounds, but you have a large variety of compounds that can be added to those jelly substances or others, including silver and copper, in nanoparticle format or not. Medical honey is also one of those materials which is heavily been investigated for treating burn wounds, stemming already from the 1930s, where it was reported for the first time. And our group and others have also focused on certain iodine-containing species, which we're trying to actually embed in an hydrogel matrix to actually develop a reservoir where the iodine compounds can be released very slowly from, leading to an antibacterial activity. Now, in the last part of the presentation, I will quickly, or let's say quickly, not quickly, but I will, with some detail still, try to also introduce to you some polymer production methods. So with that I mean, if you want to develop a final wound dressing method, you need to select which type of polymer you use, which type of bioactive compound you want to combine with that polymer. But very interesting also, you have to develop a method which can actually shape those polymers into a final implant material. And if you look at the state of the art, I can actually summarize it with one sentence from all the commercially available names that you have seen during my introductory slides. People and companies are quite often still using the very classical textile materials and also the production processes for developing those wound dresses are still the most classical methods available. Where we believe that the innovation might still be located is in applying some of those technologies: 3D printing, microparticle production, and electrospinning. Now, what is possible with those techniques? Just to introduce that to you, I've listed four different figures in which I will highlight what the capabilities of those technologies are. With 3D printing, you see actually here a perfectly, or an example of a perfectly interconnecting scaffold. So with this approach, you start from a scan of a certain medical, or let's say a defect in a patient. And this scan is then transferred to a computer, which is actually operating a 3D printing device like this one. And then you end up with a patient-specific implant material, where in this case it is also evidenced that you have a very nice interconnecting porous structure. Typically, with the normal, or let's say with the commercially available devices out of nowadays, you can go here to strut sizes of those scaffolds of 100 to 200 micrometer. Now, for some applications, you need to go smaller. The resolution has to be much bigger. And what you see here is actually a structure which was also developed through 3D printing, but not by just using a bioplotter or similar technology, but by using a process which is called two-photon polymerization. And I will not take you through all the details of that, but just to give you an indication here, this part of the structure represents 100 micrometer. So by applying 2PP, two-photon polymerization, you are actually able, on certain implant materials, to write hydrogel patterns where the features can range from the low micrometer range to actually something in between 10 and 100 nanometer. And it is well known from literature that the way that a tissue might interact to either micro or nano features is completely different. And very interestingly, combination techniques are already now also being developed on a lab level. So probably in 5 or 10 years from now, other devices will also be becoming available. Now, two last techniques I want to introduce are techniques to produce microparticles and electrospinning. I will start with the electrospinning because this technology stems from the 1940s or the 1950s, where electrospinning was applied for the first time to make a randomly distributed set of polymer fibers. And if you would look at what the diameter of those fibers is, then again they can range from somewhere in the micrometer range to 50 or 100 nanometers. And what the beauty of this electrospinning technology is all about is the fact that because of the random distribution of the fibers, you actually develop a material, a scaffold, which mimics the extracellular matrix to some extent, because our cells in our bodies are actually embedded in an extracellular matrix, which is a combination of randomly distributed collagen fibers. With this technology, you can use collagen, gelatin, or other polymers to try to more or less develop materials with a similar morphology. Then a last example here is a technique which is called electrospraying, which can be used for developing certain types of microparticles. And one of the things we're aiming at in DERMA is to combine several of those polymer processing technologies to develop novel wound dressings. You might load certain antibacterial compounds in those microparticles, and those microparticles can either be used in a hydrogel sheet, but you can also combine them with the electrospinning approach, or if you mix them during the printing process, you can have these type of scaffolds in which different types of microparticles are nicely embedded in a final scaffold material. So, in conclusion, I think from the presentation of Rachel, and I hope also from this one, it has become clear that the wound dressing market is a market where now already a very large amount of different wound dressings exist for various types of medical conditions. And the innovation, in our view, is still situated in those three fields, which, honestly speaking, are quite often also interrelated, because I introduced to you some concepts of novel wound dressing materials, but not every novel wound dressing material can be combined with every bioactive compound. So quite often you see the need for the development of novel polymers, in some cases combined with existing or novel bioactive compounds. And then of course also the, let's say the historical, but also the more recent polymer production methods are to be considered as one innovation in the field. Now, before coming to the end, I would also like to shortly introduce you an international conference which is organized later this year in Ghent, on which also some of the most recent DERMA results will be presented on. With this, I come to the end of my presentation, and from the chair, I've already learned that questions will come at the end. Okay. Thank you very much for your
time. Thank you very much.